better way to get started than to have Mayor Dennis Hilla come and introduce the County Executive Rob Asher. Mayor?
Thank you very much.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to King Street School in Portchester, New York.
I'll do it this way. Good evening and welcome to King Street School in Portchester, New York. Show of hands, who's from Portchester? Rye Brook? Harrison? Rye? Other place in Westchester? Wow. What I miss? Shout it out. Okay. Great representation here. You know, I'm delighted to be here, actually. For those of you who don't know me, it's really, this will probably be the last time, actually, that I'm going to be appearing on this stage as Portchester's mayor, because I'm just about to end my fourth term as Portchester's mayor. Funny story, and then I'll introduce our county executive, which I think this whole concept is great. So over Christmas vacation, my son gave me the Amazon Fire TV thing with Alexa. Very, very cool. And I was mulling over whether to run again for another term, and was hanging out with my wife, and we're going through, and we're kind of, we met in college, but, you know, watched TV in the 70s, I guess, before that. And we're looking at shows to watch, right? And, you know, Gilligan's Island, F Troop, we're going through some 70s stuff, and I'm saying, what do you think? Should I run? And then you go through the list, as you scroll through whatever, with that remote. I wasn't talking to Alexa at the time. And she's like, there, that one. I'm like, what? You want to watch? She's like, no, for you. What was it? It was a 70s sitcom, Dick Van Patten, Eight Is Enough. She's like, you know what? So I made the decision anyway. So I'm about, Monday at midnight, I turn into a pumpkin. But this is great. We have a great crowd here to ask the county executive. And I tell you, you know, there's a big focus I'm seeing just nationally, right? A hyper focus on municipal government at all levels. And I think that's fantastic. But local government affects your day-to-day life more than the President of the United States. And here in New York State, when we talk about local government, really, your local, you know, Nourishel, whatever, the local municipality that you know, that you live in, is local, and really the county is considered local as well. And we rely on the county for a lot of services, especially here in Portchester, where we're a village, and I know there's some issues that are here and close to home. And so anyway, it's without further ado, it's my honor and my pleasure to welcome our county executive, Mr. Rob Asher. Yeah.
Thank you very much for the introduction tonight. Thank you for your years of service here to the Village of Portchester. We appreciate it very, very much. I also want to say hello to David Gelfarb. Is David here? David is our county legislator for this district. I know he was, I think, stuck in the city, but he is the county legislator. We wanted to say thank you for all he does for the good people of this district. And Mayor Falanca, Fritz, where are you? Is he here yet? Not here yet? Okay. Gary? Thank you, Town Supervisor in Rye. So we have a whole host of officials here, and I want to thank them for coming here tonight. So I thank you for being here, no matter where you're from. I heard all over the county, that's good. Thank you for being with us. And for those of you who were at the last one, you know what we're gonna do. For those of you just tuning in, we're gonna go through some highlights, if you will, some updates on the county, and then we'll take questions for whatever question that you have. I also want to welcome all of those who are watching on television tonight. Y a mis amigos y amigas de la comunidad latina, gracias por estar aquí conmigo esta noche. Y los televidentes en Fios 1, gracias. Y mi mensaje para ustedes es bienvenidos a todos. Y no tienen miedo. Mi trabajo para ustedes, todos en el condado, es mejorar su vida. Bienvenidos. Okay, let us talk about... So So we go by the three P's, and we've used this since day one as sort of our guidepost of how to move things along, to stay focused on what we should be doing. And it really came about for why we ran and how we operate every day. So the three P's, protecting taxpayers, and we have certainly done that. In the 8 years prior to us getting into office, there was a 60% increase in the tax levy. 60%. Taxes were out of control, and people had had it. And so one of the themes was, we've got to stop this tax madness, get things under control, live within our means, and that was the challenge. And so we have gone now 7 straight years without a tax increase in the county level, and the budget today that we have is just about the same, a little lower actually, than the one we inherited. And we've done that by forcing discipline on all of our county departments and to make sure that we operate with what we have and use the dollars that were given by the taxpayers wisely. And that means we've had to reinvent ourselves, and a lot of things that we've done, we've had to change things. And in each department, we've had restructuring. But the one area, which is the Department of Social Services, has seen an increase. We are at, for the first time ever, the $600 million mark for our Department of Social Services. Now, what that means is, even though we have less people in Department of Social Services as workers, and that the county is down about 15% in our total number of employees, what that means is we're more efficient, and we're making sure more dollars that we put into it actually get to the people who need help, who need assistance. And so we are not in any way, shape, or form turning our backs on the least fortunate, just the opposite. We're making sure money goes to where it's absolutely needed. So preserving essential services is the second thing. I admit that is subjective. You know, what's important or what is essential to me or to other people may be vastly different. And that's okay, because in a budget of $1.8 billion, we can constantly move things around. And at the budget time, where we've always compromised, we have, when I started, 13 Democrats and 4 Republicans on the board. There's now 9 and 8. 9 Democrats and 8 Republicans. So it's a very split board, and it's a very bipartisan board. I mean, we work very well to move things along. We don't always agree. Sometimes we start here, they start there, and we meet in the middle. But that's how we get things done. And that's how we've been able to move things. And the third P, which is promoting economic growth, and that's the most important, because when you have a healthy economy, if you're creating jobs, if you're inviting businesses in, if you're working with our businesses and the people who create jobs, that's how you pay for the first two. That's how you can pay for the essential services, and that's how you can keep taxes stable or reduce them. And those are very important, because all three of these are extremely important. But as I said, economic development is the most vital. And I can say that we've had 44,000 new private sector jobs created in this county in the last 7 years. Now, I can't take all the credit for that, certainly not. But we have been very aggressive working with our Industrial Development Agency, our local development corporation, which we started in 2013, which helps our nonprofits in this county get low interest loans or allows them to refinance, which creates a lot of capital for our hospitals. We've had big expansions of our hospitals. Northern Westchester, Phelps, White Plains, all big expansions, creating jobs and creating the healthcare network that we need in this county. And that is a direct result of our Office of Economic Development reaching out and being aggressive, and that's a good thing. Now, if we look at why we put an emphasis on ourselves to be fiscally disciplined by not having an increase in the tax levy. You know, we've heard the arguments, and it's bandied about all the time at budget time. You have this property tax cap, right? And if we were just to increase the property tax levy 2%, that's 2%, 2% every year, compounded, is a lot of money. And that's where you get into the trouble that the county had gotten into, spending way beyond its means. And so look at the cumulative effect of 2% every year if we had done that, which we have not. 2% every year would have equaled $413 million collected from the people of this county, just for that portion of your tax bill, which is the county's. Now, I think that money deserves to stay in your pockets and not in 17 legislators and county executives. And if you see what the rate of inflation has been, it's been about 12% since the year 2010, and yet we have kept the budget at basically the exact same that we inherited, just a tiny bit less. So we're doing more efficiently, more with less, and that's the new model that should be across the board. Because the old model of what do we want to do, what do we have to do, what's the gap, there's your tax increase. That should be the last option. The last option. And we've been able to live within our means, and that's why we have not had a tax increase in those 7 years, because fiscally we're making sure we're disciplined. Okay, state mandates. We hear about this all the time. Here, and I want to thank the school district for allowing us to use the auditorium today. I really appreciate that. Schools, the village of Portchester, the towns, the county, we are all complaining, rightfully so, about these unfunded mandates. Now you hear that, so some people say, well, what is an unfunded mandate? Basically, it is a higher level of government dictating to a lower level of government what you'll do. And oftentimes, they don't come with help financially. So it's the state telling the county, you're going to pay for part of the state's bills for Medicaid. And we have no say whatsoever in the program. No say whatsoever in trying to save money. We get a bill. That bill is $212 million, all out of tax levy money. So it's 40 cents of every dollar we collect on your property tax goes to Medicaid in Albany without a say locally on how to administer it, how to find savings, nothing. So that is what an unfunded mandate is. And if you look, they're huge. And I'm not saying these programs aren't good. I'm saying these are state programs, so the state should be paying for them, not the county, and not local municipalities. So that's what I'm talking about myself on Sunday evening. Already, it sounds like my house. Preserving essential services. Okay, so here
what about
is,
the airport?
Okay, stop. Listen, we're going to have a dialogue tonight. And a dialogue means we need to have a respectful dialogue. Where I ask, you ask, and you ask. Preserving essential services. We have not had cuts to the nonprofits. We've held them harmless. We have not had a change in the parent share for daycare. We have had no tuition increase at WCC for four straight years. And we have not increased our park fees. Our bus lines, for the most part, are still the same. We make changes all the time based on ridership, but for the most part, are the same. And as I mentioned, the Department of Social Services budget is at the highest level it has ever been. Capital budget. There are three budgets that go into making a county budget. You've got the operating budget, the normal day-to-day expenses. You have the special districts, which are our wastewater treatment plants and those kind of things. And then we have the capital budget. And the capital budget is the money that we would spend on the infrastructure, our roads and our bridges and our dams and those kind of things. And of course, all of our parks and recreation. We have 50 parks. And so they've got to be upkept. Some of them, one of them, is an amusement park, and we'll talk about that. And our plan to make it self-sufficient and make it better for the public, and that's Playland. So there are a lot of things that we're doing, and we're putting a lot of money, and this is the most we have ever spent in the county for capital budgets, and certainly under our administration. I don't think there was ever this much spent on a capital budget. It's a 9% increase from last year. It's over $300 million. So we're putting a lot of money into fixing things, because right now, and we know interest rates are already starting to go up, right now it's the best time to borrow. And a year or two from now, it's going to be more expensive to do that.
Borrowing
Kensico Dam Project. So let me tell you about the project that we have proposed for Kensico. Kensico is one of our most used parks in our whole system. We have, you can ask me that question or anything you want in just a little while. Let me finish this, and then we can have a discussion. So,
thank you.
So, Kensico has hundreds of thousands of people that visit it every year. It is right smack in the middle of our county. It is accessible from everywhere, and it's beautiful. And with the background of the Kensico Dam itself, which has been refurbished by New York City, it really is a wonderful place to be. Now, the problem with Kensico, as I see it, is this big, long, 740-foot-long pit. And that, for those of you who remember, there used to be reflecting pools there. And it was a popular attraction. And for whatever reason, it went into disrepair, and the previous administration shut off the fountains, which were falling apart anyway, in I think 2007 or 2008. And so it's been sitting there as a place for geese to gather. And it's really not an attractive thing when you're at Kensico and everything is beautiful except this long concrete pit. So the complaint I hear the most from residents at at Kensico that visit is, what are you gonna do with that? And what we hear all the time was, can it be back to what it was? And skating. And Winter Wonderland, if anyone has been to Winter Wonderland, has been a phenomenal success. It's now 3 years, and it started off with a little rinky-dink ice rink, and it got a little bit bigger, but still nowhere near a regulation size. So the plan for Kensico is to restore the fountains, and they'd have 9 fountains that would shoot water 30 feet up. You would have a reflecting pool. It is important to some people. You would have a reflecting pool in the warm weather, and then that would be transformed in the cold weather as part of an extended winter wonderland. Now, I want to correct one thing. It is being spread. It is being spread that it is a $24 million rink. That is off by $20 million. It is a $4 million rink. The fountains and the work for the piping is $6 million for the reflecting pool and all the work that has to be there. There's a maintenance facility that was scheduled. What we did was we took projects that had already been approved in the capital budget and move them forward, as opposed to doing them 4 years from now, and made it one project where we would fix up Kensico, we would add the rinks, we would have the reflecting pool finished, and we would have the shed, the maintenance facility, which is needed, no matter what we do, is still needed over there. As well as, if anyone's ever tried to go to Kensico and get food, it's awful. As far as the physical building, it is an old concrete, dilapidated building with awful bathrooms that was built in the 70s, and that would be torn down and made into a nice dining facility. So that is the vision for the Kensico. Let me talk about the airport, because there's also a lot of misinformation going about the airport. I know you're excited, I know it's exciting. Go through it, then you can talk about what you disagree with. I see your disagree sign, that's fine. But I'm going to give you the facts on the airport. These are facts. Here are the facts. The airport. Listen up. People want to hear all over the county the actual facts, and this is why I'm here. I want to get information out, and then I'll get your opinion, right, wrong, or indifferent. Whether you like it or not, that's fine. That's why we're here. I want you to tell me yes or no. That's okay.
No!
So listen up.
No!
Here's the deal.
Yes!
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 Excuse me, let's listen up because we're going to run out of time. We're not making any progress here, okay?
So let me give you the facts on the airport. Let's go back in history, first of all. The airport was turned over from the federal government to the county during World War II. It went from a military airport to a general purpose airport. The county took it over in 45. And since that day, it has always had a private company managing the airport for the county since 1945. The current contract calls for the county to pay the operator $1 million a year plus every expense. We pay for all of their employees. We pay for everything that is done at the airport. And the airport is very expensive. So any money that comes into the airport, any revenue, by federal law, is not permitted to be used for general purposes. So we can't take any money that's at the airport and use it for our parks, for our police, for our health department, any of that stuff. It has to stay at the airport. However, there's a law that was passed in 1996 under President Clinton and the Congress at the time. And it's administered by the FAA, and it allows small and medium-sized airport, which we would qualify as, to take advantage of 10 slots. There are 10 slots nationally. And so Puerto Rico Airport took advantage of this and transformed the airport. We have an opportunity here to have a private company come in, as we already do, but it would reverse the tables. We, the county taxpayers, would actually be able to keep the revenue that comes into the airport. The private company would be responsible, just as the current one is, for the day-to-day operations. They would pay for their own employees. They would be responsible at far less cost. They would be responsible for the construction and the maintenance of the airport. Now, there are safeguards. It has been said that we are selling the airport. No, not right. Wrong. The county still owns the airport, and we will own that property in perpetuity. We would have a long-term lease, a 40-year lease, where the operator would operate the airport under this lease. What they cannot do is build another runway or lengthen the runway. They cannot change the terminal use agreement. They cannot add gates. We have four gates at the airport. That is the biggest check in having more flights. LaGuardia has, 80-something or 90-something gates. So we cannot be LaGuardia North because we have four gates, and it will remain four gates. And the passenger cap, the passenger cap will stay where it is. So we're keeping basically the essence of it, giving it to a different company, and we're getting a 40-year revenue stream. That is how you keep taxes stable without selling the passenger cap. Is the airport deal with environmental safeguards written into the lease. Now, where is it right now? Right now, the Board of Legislators and the administration have a task force made up of two Democrats and one Republican. They have been meeting consistently since the beginning of the year. They have hired, at $500,000, but that comes out of the airport, we have hired a world-renowned company that everyone agreed to, that has looked at the request for proposals, that has looked at the lease, and they have said that it is a good lease that we put together. It is now going out for proposals either Friday or Monday. We'll have 3 months for interested parties to basically to bid, and we will vet them. And then ultimately, the Board of Legislators, and I see David Gelfarb is here. There he is. You know, David was very instrumental in really making sure that a lot of the environmental protections were in there. He lives here, obviously, and so the neighborhood and the safeguard of the neighborhood, that's all very important, not just to David Gelfarb, but to all of us. And so we wanted to make sure that's directly in the lease. So that's where it is. It will be out in the summer, and at some point in the summer, we will evaluate with the board. And the board and the administration will select, and if it's either going to happen or not by the end of the year. So it is potentially a very big deal for the county. And by the way, we may have been leading on this because St. Louis Airport has just applied, and there are apparently others that are now looking at this opportunity